say you never lost hope?
Never lost hope, not once. Once I saw my mama, after I found out what happened, I swear to God, I wasn't scared of nothing. No, I was telling the nurses, like, man, I'm going to tell my mama on you. Every time they say no to me about something, like, all right, you know what? I got you. Watch my mama come up here. Chief, I got you. Everything.
All right, so what's the hardest part, like, of this whole process, though, for you?
Just people not seeing me the same, or my kids not, you know, just looking at me like crazy, like, who is he? You know, when I hold my arm out, like, come here, baby. Come get in my wheelchair with daddy. You know, just staring at me all crazy. They don't know me no more. It hurt a little bit. Being called handicapped and all that and stuff.
My name is Roderick Martin, Taki Inch, better known on the streets as Doodoo. I'm 23 years old, and I was shot in the back of my head at the age of 20, which was 2 years ago, December 21st, 2010. I'm from 39th Street, the project.
So where you from? Where you born?
I'm from the low end, south side of Chicago. 39th Street, better known as the Ida B. Wells Projects.
How you been out your whole life? You moved?
I mean, we moved out when I was like 13 or 14. I can't exactly remember.
Why y'all moved?
I mean, they was closing the projects down.
All right, man, tell me a little bit about your childhood, man. Tell me about how you grew up, stuff you been through.
Man, we all grew up like throwing rocks at cars and stuff, you know. Typical, like, you know, kids stuff, you know, boys, what boys do. Playing basketball. I used to play Little League for the Blue Jays. You know, we went kind of far with that. Little League and Pony League, Teenage League, right?
So what happened, man? What about, like, you know, when you start growing up and get a little bit older into your, like, teenage years, like, you feel like the streets kind of sucks you into a certain type of lifestyle, or?
The streets and girls. Yeah, you right about that.
What you mean by that? What type of lifestyle are we talking about?
I mean, seeing all my friends with a lot of money in their pockets, like coming to school with all that, like the girls wanted me because I had long hair, you know? I just changed.
See, I didn't have that much money coming up when you were a kid?
I I mean, we had food stamps like every other family.
Food stamps is good. But I'm saying, like, y'all was struggling, y'all had issues. You know, a lot of black families in America, you know, they kind of going through issues, been going through issues in, like, you know, late 70s and early 80s and on.
I mean, we got back. I put it like that. My mama did what she could and what she was supposed to do for her kids. And, like, my thing was, like, I always wanted my little sisters to be straight. You know, forget me, my big brother and little brother. I just wanted my little sisters to be okay.
So you felt like you had to protect them?
Nope.
You just want them to be okay?
Yeah. Straight. I ain't never got to ask no nigga for nothing, no none of that, you know?
All right. So you talk about your mama, like, what about your dad? Was he in your life?
Nah, man, that man was locked up. He been locked up since before I was born. I was born in 1990. He was locked up since 1989. He had 20 years. For whatever reasons, I forget. And like he got out in 2009, and I was 19. You know, we been kind of bonding a little bit. Been into it a few times, you know. Misunderstandings, you know how it go.
So what type of effect did not having a father in your life play on your life? Like, did it really affect your life big time, or?
Yeah, game banging, you know, shooting guns, fighting too much. Like, yeah, I would have graduated high school had he been out here. Cause, you know, he was like supposed to been a top football player, baseball player, something like that. And that's what me and my big brother was doing. And like, you know, we was good at it. You know, we could be somewhere kind of big if we ain't get off into the lifestyle that we did.
My name is Nene, as they all call me. And I just met Doodle this year. At first it started him calling his godmama Boosie phone or whatever, and he wanted her to come see him, but she kept telling him like, Nene don't ride the bus, or she don't walk, she ain't gonna come over there or whatever, and I ain't gonna leave her in the house. But then he called, he was like, you better get on the bus or whatever. But then one day he just came over, he met me and my little Mexican girl named Enge, and Doodle told me about his story or whatever. I took his story to heart because I actually work in the medical field. I'm a CNA. I work with people like him all the time. And I feel bad that this happened to him, but I always remind him that it's good that he's still the person that he was, because I didn't meet nobody that laugh like he do or tell jokes like he do all the time.
Right.
And he has his situation or whatever, but he's still a good person or whatever. So, I mean, he cool, he all right.
Life is hard for me. It's so hard for me now because, like, I need help doing everything. I have to get permission, like, to do stuff I used to do all the time. Even if it's harmless, I still have to have permission from my mother. It's just so crazy, man. Because of the stroke I had to, man, just, you know, build my body back. Just a little bit, like, it's not all the way back right yet, but I'm better than what I was. When I came home, I was so messed up, you know, in diapers, everything. I used to walk, my mother used to walk me to the toilet. I couldn't even wipe my own ass. Like, it took me a long time, you know, to get to it. But I know one thing, the first thing I'm gonna do When I learn how to walk again, I'm taking my babies to the park. I got 4 kids, I'm taking them all to the park. I don't give no fuck with nobody saying I'm taking them all to the park.
I like how you say when I learn how to walk again. So you basically saying you know it's gonna happen, 100% it's gonna happen.
Yeah. See, I never lost full use of my legs. Like, it was just, never was paralyzed from the waist down. It's just the size of the stroke, I don't know what kind it was. I was just paralyzed, temporarily paralyzed on the left side of my body. which was my leg, you know, my hand and my left ball.
Oh my God.
No, I'm just playing, my bad. You gotta get that. No, for real though. I don't know if it didn't work, but when I tried to use it, it did. Said what? I remember my first time running away when we were standing in the projects. It was so funny and crazy because I got a bad report card and I was scared because somebody already told me like my mom was gonna get me. So I made a dumb decision because I wrote a letter and told her that I was running away and ran like to one of my friend's houses and spent the night up there, and she sent my little brother and my cousin to come get me. And I told them, like, if y'all touch me, first nigga touch me, I swear to God, I'm finna knock y'all out. And they got scared and left. But, like, she was chasing me, like, the whole day, and I was a whole step ahead of her each time. Like, she was getting close. Like, I was thinking it out, like, mapping it out so I wouldn't get caught. But she caught me at a place, like, I least expected it. Because I already ran away inside the projects, and I lived in the projects. Oh my God, I'm stuck.
So what else happened, man, that led you to go deep into, like, you know, living a certain lifestyle, that gang life?
Man, getting some money. The money do it.
So it's all about money?
Yeah. Money make the world go round. You see, like, I'm telling you, I felt like I was on top of the world. I was getting a little money. I was getting with my guys who I was hustling with. You know, I even got a tattoo. I mean, this the reason I got that tattoo. Because I was on top of the world, and I felt like the world was mad. I could buy anything, any girl I wanted. Still recording? I could have any girl I wanted. Man, and then, like, you know, it just got even crazier because some of the guys who I was hanging with had beef in the neighborhoods, and like that kind of like started putting like guns in my hand, like fast, way faster than what it was, than what it was doing already. And I started drifting off into a whole nother lifestyle, a shooter lifestyle, because the violence level was so crazy up here, man. It's crazy though, nobody fight no more. Everybody wanna shoot a gun. That's how I go, up here.
Hello, my name is Livia Hinkle, and I am the mother of Roderick Enge, AKA Doodle. Everybody know that is my son. He was born March 29th, 1990. He weighed 5 pounds, 15 ounces, and that was the worstest labor I ever went through. He was the smallest child. He was the second to be born. And he was a joy. When he came into this world, I can honestly say it was just tears of joy. Outweighed the pain, the labor, you know. As he grew, he was a feisty little boy. He couldn't keep still for nothing, for nobody. We went through a procedure with him, whereas to his skull wasn't closing properly. And he had small gashes, where so you could still push his skull in or whatever. They thought something was wrong, but as they, you know, checked him out, it was like, there's nothing wrong with him. He's healthy. So gradually the little holes, that's what I want to call them in the skull, they closed up. And this child became so smart. So willing to learn just about everything. There was nothing that you can put in front of him that he wouldn't try to accomplish, you know. As he got into his, I want to say his adolescent years, you know, every child does bad things. Wasn't nothing major. Scared to come home because he got a bad report card, called himself running away. He didn't even run away from home. He just ran away in the neighborhood. That was the funny part about it. He got caught. Yeah, he got punished for it, you know. I mean, that's the only right thing to do. But, you know, teenage year came along. Now we're dealing with high school. Very smart, on a roll. He was in the, he had all honor classes. So he was very smart, very smart. And was a ladies' man. He loved the ladies. He loved sports. He started out with baseball. Then gradually he proceeded to basketball, in which I definitely saw a talent there. Either way, you know, things happen and children get misguided, you know, and what you think your child will understand what he or she's supposed to do out here, they have a different sense, they have their own mind. And through that, he didn't finish high school, you know, he dropped out. As a mom, that saddened me because I knew his capability and, you know, what I wanted him to do in life, you know. The road that I was trying to get him to go down, he chose not to go down. He chose to follow his own path. You know, through this, you know, my grandbabies came along. Love them to death. And they become my world, you know. As time progressed and everything, he had needed to go stay with his godmother for a bit. You know, we had gotten in a situation, and she gave us her help. You know, this was a young lady I had been knowing for a nice little minute. She treated all my children the same. Her name is Giovanna Miller, AKA Boosie. And I love her for that. She was there for my son when the next person wouldn't be. And we actually really needed that help. But, okay, through the process, you know, your children do stuff that you don't want them to do, but it's because they're trying to find their own way. And you want them to find their own way. You don't want to have to guide them through everything. You just want them to be smart about things, you know? Yeah, you say, a child say, I'm grown now. I don't need my mom. I don't need my folks. But when it's all said and done, number one person, you have to fall back on. They still here. They gonna be there for you. Like I am for him. That's all I can do. And just hope and pray for the best.
That's what you're doing.
Stop looking at the camera. See, you ain't need no apple. Do your regular daily thing that you do.
This is my documentary.
It's your documentary.
No way, let's play chess.
I'm saying, be you.
I don't play chess.
What's
your
name?
I said chess.
I don't play chess.
Be you,
I play checkers. I beat your ass.
And she's has about you.
Yes.
Nope,
nah. See, you doing you.
I'll give you a secret.
You're doing you.
Stand up.
You're doing you. But I'm making you look sexy. What you mean?
So you already look sexy.
Man, it's too late for that.
I'm making you look extra sexy. What you mean?
What you saying?
It's too late
for that. Don't get no fucking face in your sexy face? What you say? Don't give a fuck.
This side of my face? Well, I don't give a fuck. Crazy.
What's the other side? Huh? Your LL Cool J side? You always licking your lips.
You need something.
Look. My lips like that. Let me tell you, my lips like that. Look, I'm gonna tell you how they like that. Look,
playing with your lips.
Look, they like that. They like that because I, don't you know, on this other song, I can do that. Baby girl, just
put on it, baby. Put it on there. You definitely need some. You definitely need some, baby.
Leave me, get them.
Nice, get them.
Right.
Yeah, they exposing me. Talking about lips. trying to braid my hair, everything.
You on camera though, you don't want your lips to be all dry and crusty.
What?
I mean, they, you up. I mean, if I ain't touching them, maybe I'm more than white.
They gonna be like, it's crusty, look
bad, nigga. What's up? Yeah, I'm gonna nibble.
See, now you look
good. 99.9% of disabled people got crusty lips.
What's that little crusty out? Mac? Yeah, you like you got on some Mac now. Give me a kiss. Give me a kiss, baby. Give me a kiss.
I'm trying to tell you, look, 99.9% of disabled people got crusty lips.
You ain't disabled, motherfucker. You're sitting in the goddamn chair. Stupid. You do too much. You ain't disabled. You're sitting in the chair. Because you play too damn much, baby. People don't do that.
We gotta get all the way down there, boy.
Yeah, put my fans up first. We both gonna fall.
Both of y'all bust on tilt over too. We gotta get all the way down. Let's try again. Come on. You ain't standing up right, Duda.
Purple
light,
boy.
Let me go right there.
Remember? Yep.
Cheek.
Yep.
Balance yourself.
Let me go.
You get it?
No, number one rule? How about this? Let's show him what you're doing. I'm just scared.
That's what you're doing.
Mom, do not get this one out.
Stop. Relax. All right.
Relax.
Let him go, Tony.
Relax.
Ooh! You got it, baby. Stop thinking about that.
I ain't about to refrigerate.
It's okay.
We got you, man.
You already better than being refrigerator.
Get situated with them legs.
Yeah.
Right there. Separate them. Yeah, the width of your shoulders should be the width of your feet. Come on,
one of them.
If it's leaning that way, what way are you supposed to lean? Nope. Wrong. Supposed to lean to the strong side. Right. Strong side carries your weight.
Talk to the gun.
Don't lean at you. Just look up. Focus on the camera. And remember, you're stepping there.
Started from the bottom.
Lean to the right. Lean to your right.
You got it.
Go ahead. We're right here.
Ooh!
Yeah. Woo!
See? You got it!
It's called progress, y'all. It's called progress.
And he got it. He got it.
Boss. All we got is time.
True.
No regrets. Boss.
True.
We ain't gonna rush it.
That's how
you sit right down?
Nope.
We ain't finna hold your ass all day now.
Yes, we is.
All right.
You gotta go get my son.
That's why I'm gonna go.
Hey, Leah.
Listen, no, I'm not gonna hold you. I'm gonna go.
Right. Mm. No, don't look at
you. Can do it. You can do it though. Hey,
you scared of phone?
Okay, forget it. Sean, have me came.
Hello, how y'all doing?
How you doing? Mm. I just sent you over here before.
Now here. Here. Now stand up yourself.
My feet is all.
You know how to do it.
Come on, man, I gotta finish showing out for the camera.
Hey, come on.
Oh, man.
Okay.
You
gonna sit down now?
Yeah. Let's try one more time.
Yeah. As long as he got you. Do I need to comb my hair?
Too late.
You look like you was going through it like that.
I know.
See the church.
Oh, I'm hot. Come on, Ray.
Yes,
it's cute.
Thank you. I think we should like take a season, like all of us have one thing.
No. Make yourself one. Come on, here we go.
Yeah, what's name is Blink?
Because his name old.
Use it, nigga.
Let me still on you with the left.
Come on.
I'm doing a repeat. Your face turn.
Just turn
right.
Around.
Just turn right. I'm turning your face towards my way.
Come on. I'm gonna strap this one down. You gotta use it.
Wait, I missed.
That's why you missed.
Come on.
Nope, you said
come
no
on. I missed. Come on, man.
I'm out of here. Let me do that,
man. You gonna do my socks?
I'm coming, man. Yeah, go back and relax your pills for it.
I told who wouldn't want to come over.
One day, it was approximately about 8:15, 8:30 in the morning. And my son, Roderick, calls me, say, Mom, what you doing? I said, nothing. He said, I'm bored. I said, well, baby, come on over. He said, okay, Mom, I'll be over there. It was actually 3 days before my birthday. And a young lady by the name of Janice was doing my hair. And my phone was wrong. And my baby boy, my third son, was screaming, Ma, this bee just shot my brother in the head.
Okay, see, what happened was December 21st, 2010, a girl I was messing with, she popped up on me. For what reasons, I really don't know.
Before all that happened, I was downtown partying with my friends. I come home early that morning, and we just chilling for a minute. And the girl that came over, she popped up at the crib. She had a child with her. She wanted to see him before she left and go out of town.
I can't understand why, but she had her baby with her. And you know, bad being December 21st, I just didn't let her, you know, stand the cold out there. So I told them to come in.
And for what reasons, I don't know, I was mad. And we went in my room and started arguing.
And she came over, but she wasn't really posed to. And they got into a little slight argument. But they were in the room, I was in the front room, chilling with my cousin, we smoking. Next thing you know, I hear a gunshot go off.
And I ended up telling her, like, you know what, I got a girlfriend, get out. And she like, what? I'm like, I got a girlfriend, get out. Next thing you know, it was over, boom.
I run to the back, and I see my brother on the floor, lifeless. I ain't know what to do at that moment, but I was in like a certain panic. And I don't really like to relive it like that, but he was kind of like, he was dead. I rolled him over, he wasn't breathing or nothing. But the will in me and knowing what we've been through together, I had to do something about it. I did CPR, he coughed up blood, and I had to keep him breathing until the ambulance came. And luckily for me, I helped save my brother's life.
I was called, you know, I had some friends, you know, called my sister phone, they had told me, like, Deuce, yeah, I got shot in the head, man. I ran to the crib, you know, I grabbed my guns, I ain't gonna lie, but I grabbed my guns, we had went down there, and I got down there, they had told me, like, man, yeah, I got shot by a female. So, you know, I do, they told me that she had a baby. We followed her on the stroller track. We followed the stroller track. We kicked in every door. You know, we kicked in every door we could, because I ain't gonna lie, I wanted to kill her. No,
When he got shot, I was actually in my mama room watching her getting her head did, and she got a call, and the only thing she was saying, like, doodle dead, and it shocked me. All I did was just walk out the room, and I was in shock. I couldn't do nothing. Everybody asked me, like, what's wrong, and I'm screaming, and I'm hollering, I'm crying. I couldn't really control myself. Everybody was running out. Everybody running out the house. My mama Fabi came out and told everybody. Everybody ran out the house, and by the time we made it over to his house, everybody was going, police is everywhere. So when we made it to the hospital, only thing I could do is just help him, like, pray to God, like, please let my brother be okay. Please don't let him die. Like, he been through so much. My mama been through so much, so please don't let, like, please don't take him away.
I wasn't for sure if that's what he said. So I yelled back, calm down, sit, what you say? He say, man, this bitch just shot my brother in the head. So the only thing I could do was just scream for my oldest son, my firstborn, another one of my pride and joys. And I grabbed my jacket and I walked out the door. I didn't know how I was gonna get to him, but I know I just needed to get to my baby. And when I say my baby, I mean my baby. All six of my kids are my babies. I got on the bus, still not for sure if my son was dead or alive. I made it, I want to say right up under the Vidout, going towards State Street on 63rd. And the police stopped the bus, not knowing that they was actually looking for the person who had just shot my son. Once they let the bus go ahead, it proceeded on down. Once we made it to the street, I stopped, I got off the bus, and I started running through the snow. It's cold, but oh well. There's only one person that's on my mind right now. That's my baby. As I'm trying to get to the house, you know, I got friends and, you know, family, they running up to me, and they're trying to stop me from actually going to the place where he was shot at. But the only thing I wanted was just to get to him. That's all. Just to let him know his mom is here. Baby, you're not gonna be by yourself. Your mom is right here. I am so sorry. I'm so sorry because I should have been there. I should have took that bullet for my baby. As a mother, I'm willing to die and go to hell for mine.
As far as him getting shot, I was in Arkansas when it happened. As far as me getting the news, not being able to be there for him when he first got shot, it was devastating. Me being stuck out there for a week after it happened. And we were stuck out there for that week. There was nothing we can do but cry. And then when we finally got back from Arkansas, we came back. Me going to the hospital to see him, it was like weakening. I was lightheaded. I couldn't see him in the hospital. He was hooked up to all these machines, tubes and everything down his throat. He couldn't talk. I ain't know how to handle it.
They tell me the ambulance has taken him already. I ask the question, I say, is my son still alive? They say, just get to the hospital. His last baby mom and her mom, they put me in the truck with them and off to Northwestern Hospital's where we went. Once I got there, I go straight on the inside. They instructed me to go into this little room. But for some odd reason, I felt like God made me put on brakes. He wouldn't let me go in this little room because I felt that little room holds nothing but bad news. So I paused, and as I paused, the doctor comes out. I'll never forget his name, Dr. Tripp. He said, are you his mother? I said, yes, I am. He said, this is what's going on now. And I stopped him. I said, this is your job. Whatever you need to do, just do it. Just keep my baby here with me. He don't have to speak. He don't have to see. He don't have to do nothing. Just keep my baby here. Please just don't let my baby leave us. This is not his time. He said, okay, so I have your permission. I said, yes, you do. Meaning that they needed to remove the skull. Because by this time, the brain had done started swelling. God is good, because see, the brain could have started swelling while he was laying on the floor. His brain didn't start swelling until he actually got to the hospital where help was at. You may think God don't work with you, walk with you, be there for you. You gotta have faith though. And that's the only thing I could do was put it in God's hands. And with that being said, they reached him. They got him. They did what they had to do. He's been through so much. I had to make life-changing decisions for him. I had to give these doctors permission to close off his hearing. Because spinal fluid was leaking through the ear and it could have killed him. I had to give them permission to remove muscles from his leg to seal off the ear. I had to give them permission to cut off an artery from his brain. You know? And as a mother, I feel so bad. And I don't want to be like I'm the selfish person to keep him here. It was worth it. It's worth it. And I felt I gave up my life. I don't care if I was partying, doing this, doing that, doing it. Because see what I gave up? It's 10 times more better than what I'm going through. When I say it's a blessing and it's an honor to be by his side, and see the things that he's accomplished. I done went through so much with him, you know? But that's what a mother's supposed to do. It's all you can do. Is be there for that one you gave birth to, you know?
I woke up in the hospital, I swear to God, like, I thought I was asleep. I woke up to some lady calling my name in my ear, my left ear. I looked around. As I looked around, I see my mama sitting on the left side of me, looking down at me, smiling, kind of, you know, teary-eyed or whatever. And then she asked me, she like, you remember what happened to me? I couldn't talk. I couldn't talk at the time, so I was like, I just shook my head like, nope. She like, you got shot in the back of your head. My reaction like, wow, really? And I'm still alive. You know, she got to telling me like what the girl in jail for, like, I mean, what they charged her with, what her bond was. You know, it's kind of crazy. And she told me like, I couldn't walk. You know, heartbreaking. Told me I couldn't walk. I swear, like, I felt like getting up right then and there. But then she caught herself like, but you gonna go to rehab and get therapy so you can walk again. My reaction was, I just shook my head, yeah, like, not thinking of like how hard it was gonna be.
I did what I had to do to keep him alive. And that's why he's here with us today.
My name is Katina Allen. I'm Roderick's cousin, and his situations have affected me tremendously. That's my little cousin, and it's like things is not the same no more because he feel like he disabled and he's not. You know, he's still a human being, and I just pray to God that he get himself back together to where he could feel human again. What he's going through is like very heartbreaking for me. I'm used to my cousin dancing with me, going outside, we having fun, you know, and we can't do those things anymore. So I just, you know, I would love to have him back again. Yes, he is human. He still have his sense of humor. He's still silly. He just can't do the things that he used to do. And one day he will be able to. And I love my little cousin, and I just hope he get out of his situation.
Or whatever, but since the accident or whatever, since he got shot, he been all right. Like, he get on my nerves. It affected me bad because I'm used to him coming over here playing with me. We play fight, wrestle, getting the boxing gloves, box, all type of stuff. And now he not the same no more to me because other simple fact, he in a wheelchair. He can't move parts of his body. It affected me badly for the simple fact this is my brother. This is my favorite brother. He get on my nerves every day, like right before you just came. We just got into it or whatever. But he know I still love him deep down. Kind of sad, so I think it affected everybody, but at the same time, I think it affected me the most besides my mama because this is my favorite brother. And you know, you shouldn't have no favorite, but still, like, he can't get up and walk. We can't get up and walk to the store. He used to call me like, Chichi, come beat this girl up for me, or something like that. And he just not the same no more. I ain't used to him sitting there in the house or just asking everybody to do stuff. I'm used to him running around, being a hothead, or going to do stuff on his own. But now, I mean, he good. Everything happened for a reason. I'm just glad he's still here.
Now he on the rampage, getting better, trying to walk, use his left hand. Huh?
I said then what?
Just taking everything day by day. Everything gonna get better.
He's straight though. He just get on my nerves sometimes, man. We argue all the time. I'm ready to smack the dog shit out of him. You know, but that's my cousin, man. I'm just blessed that he's here right now, man. I can laugh with him, fight with him, talk shit every day with him, you know. But he gonna be cool, man, with Ace Ventura looking at.
You don't wanna go there.
Say who you are and then how it affected you.
I'm Brandy Dyer.
You know what, Eddie Jones?
I'm Brandy Dyer. I'm Roderick's best friend. And his situation has affected me tremendously.
So you stop, people?
It's good. Leave me alone. He just has. I don't look at him any different. I still look at him the same. He's still my best friend. And I'm gonna do everything in my power to keep helping him go on so he won't feel like he's any lower than anyone else. Cause he's not, and I love him. He's my big fat best friend.
Oh, tear. Tear.
And right about now, we're on the path to trying to walk again.
I took them off Pampers. I took them off all this medication that they had them on. They said always keep giving him Jevity. It's a liquid food. I said no. We started out with White Castles. It's White Castle burgers. White Castle burgers, we went to double cheeseburgers. Now he eats like a racehorse. No. Stop. Please. It's been trials and tribulations with it. We done had our ups, our downs. And I had to show some hardcore mother love, whereas to, I'm not gonna keep doing everything for you. Now he know how to pull up on the refrigerator, stand up, use the microwave on his own. I won't let him cook on the stove. That's only because we won't take no risks like that. You know, microwave, that's fine, but we're not gonna do the stove yet, not just yet. Other than that, it's been hard, but it's a life lesson that we learned.
At this point in time, we had recorded so much footage. I mean, hours and hours of footage we recorded. What was really cool about this point in time in the film, I mean, Roderick actually started to take full initiative and he wanted to produce this thing himself. He wanted to be in control of just how much the world knew. He wanted to be in control of how he was, you know, displayed to the world. He wanted to tell, and I respected him for that. And I still do to this day. I kind of feel like it wasn't just him that got shot that day. It was his whole family that took that bullet. And for him, it was a life-changing experience, but more a formative experience. And Dusky knew that. He really, really wanted story his way, on his terms. Because nobody actually knows better than him.
Wanted to walk again. But when I got to rehab, it was kind of crazy. Actually, you know, everything was just hard because as a result of me being shot in the back of my head, I had a stroke because I got shot on the back right side, and the right side of your brain controls the left side of your body. And funny story about that is I never knew about it because my doctors was coming in my room every night, grabbing my left foot and my left hand, telling me to wiggle my fingers and wiggle my toes. And like, I just shake my head like, no, couldn't do it. Then they came in that one night when my mama came up there to spend the night with me. And then they came in there, and then I was like, Mom, why they keep doing that? And then she was like, that's because you had a stroke, baby. I'm like, oh, okay. I put my head down like this. Then I was like, I look up, I say, wait a minute, ain't that for old people? She say, no. Young people could have them too. I really thought it was for old people. I swear I felt so stupid. Like,
it was just, I thought it was. And what was messed up, like, because if I would have just came out the headshot, just survived it without the stroke, I'd be okay to this day. But like, due to complications, like as a result, like, of the bullet, I keep saying, like, I'm not trying to do that. Like, as a, I just did it again.
It's tight.
No, I'm saying though, like, as a result of the course that the bullet took through my brain, like, it burnt out the back of my right eye. You know, and like, it came out like just under my left eye somewhere. And I was so lucky because it could have hit both. I could be completely blind right now.
You willing to show people the damage you took on the right side of your eye?
Yeah, ain't nothing. You see me? You see my eye too?
I still got my eye on that, y'all. I don't look retarded or nothing.
Nah. Right.
Anything else?
Alright, Dusky, if there's anybody like you want to talk to right now who live in the same type of lifestyle, like what would you say to them? They live in that lifestyle right now, they watching this right now.
Man, stop what you're doing right now and just stop, because it ain't all it's cracked up to be, trust me. I did a lot, I done seen a lot. It really ain't what it is, trust me, what you think it is. It's not like that.
What if they feel like they getting money and they trying to, you know, feed their kids too, you know?
You can't take none of it with you. Really, you can't take no money with you when you die. I mean, get a job. Stack for your kids, stack your bread for your kids. I mean, for the future. You know, for like the year 3000 or something.
So,
you know,
let's just say.
To a business or something.
To a business? So you would never, ever, ever condone this type of lifestyle, like, ever again. Like, if you, when you got better, you wouldn't go back to the block.
I mean, what's some wood at? Because I can't never say never, but that ain't my intentions right now. I just want to get back out here, get a little stable, you know, get my own.
So what's next?
You know, therapy.
After therapy, when you get up and running again, what's next for you?
Taking my babies to the park.
After that?
Gonna go get some cutting.
I have a soft spot for people, so I mean, it is what it is. He real cool. He real cool.
Oh no,
you just took all my action.
I said it right there.
You ain't said it nowhere, boo boo.
I did say it right there.
Y'all see that? Life is so different for me now because, like, my respect level has changed. Like, well, the level of respect, like, that people have for me has changed, like, because it's easier for me to get into it with everybody, because I don't like when people ignore me, or basically when people tell me no, because I'm in a situation that I'm in. And it's easy. And like my baby mamas, you know, they talk to me different. You know, tell me stuff I don't wanna hear. Doing stuff I ain't never liked them doing. But I can't control that. So, done with it. No, I don't care. No, take the laugh out.
So the worst part is not being able to have control, right?
Huh?
So the worst part about like right now is not being able to like have control. Like,
I mean, it wasn't never that I even had control. It's just like we was cool though. Like, because they out here doing the stuff that they doing. You know, I always want to argue me, telling me, you know what, B, you don't do S-H-I-T for my baby anyway. Who this? Nah, I could been not just done, bought them some shoes or something, outfits or whatever. You know, and it don't matter what I do, they always hit me with that. Not all of them, but 75% of them. And I got four. So that's three of them.
You got four people you had kids with?
Huh?
What'd you say, you have four what?
I got four baby mamas. Four different baby mamas.
Have they supported you since the incident?
No. I mean, yeah, like they bought me like white castles and stuff.
They bought you food, that's it?
That's just about it. I mean, something off that link card or something. That's just about it. Other than that, no. The one who I was in a relationship with, no. I ain't holding no grudge against her neither, but like, her support for me just been no.
You were telling me last time about your friends that, you know, didn't really stick around. People that claim to be your friends, but they weren't nowhere to be found when you needed them. It's still like that now?
Yeah. I mean, forget it. I ain't chasing nobody to be my friend. It is what it is. Bye.
So right now, all you really got is family?
That's it.
I just got my mama, brothers and sisters, and my grandma.
So you say, would you say blood is thicker than water then? You think you learned that now?
Yeah.
So about your goals, concerned, last time you were telling me about like your kids, taking your kids to the park and stuff. What are the other future goals you got right now?
I want to go see a couple of people. I'm going to, and I'm going to get me some cutty. I'm going to get me some cutty, cuz like now it's like I have to sit here and wait, like on a female to feel like they want to give me some, or they horny enough to give me some, or feel like degrading themselves or something. Nah, that's just crazy. Like, back then I could just, it was what it was, man. So I'm saying, either you gonna give me some or you ain't. And if they said no, I was gonna keep moving. Nah, it's crazy. All right.
Do you think your life gonna be different? Think any changes gonna happen in the next couple of years?
Yeah, everybody gonna be trying to come back around. Yeah, trying to get some of this money, some of this disabled money. I ain't saying no. I got kids. I ain't sharing none of my money.
All right, what would be the most valuable lesson you learned out of this whole situation? Everything was just wrapped up in one.
Trust. Like, can't trust everybody. Like, I ain't saying I trusted the girl that shot me, but I just learned that though. Like, in my whole situation, like, people lie to me. People just, man, it's crazy. I don't even want to get all into that. It's crazy though.
You saying about like some of your relationship before then or before everything happened?
Yeah, we had a relationship way before then, since childhood.
No homo.
Wait, yeah, no homo, man. But that's my brother. Like my brother, man. Been through a lot, lived with me and everything.
So you never felt like you was gonna give up on him? Like when after you saw him laying there on the ground, you never really felt like for a minute he wasn't gonna make it?
I couldn't give up on him. This a forever person to me, you know? Forever my brother, for life. He gotta be here with me when I make it through everything. I can't just see him go like that. And this a person that was with me damn every day of my life. So, I just didn't want that to happen.
Nah, what we supposed to talk about? Doodle wife. The fuck is gonna realize if he said doodle on the camera?
Dooski.
It's my man, 100 grand, man, you know? I know him for a long time. I go to high school with his little brother or whatever. First time I met this guy, he actually smacked me. Like I was a bitch or something, though. But, yeah, you know, we had a lot of
opportunity. You can't cuss? No, man. Just
why?
Professional.
All right, let me come on. First time I actually met this guy, he actually got an altercation or whatever. I got into his little brother. He put his hand on me or whatever. My pops came his pants and running with his squash or whatever. I said, see a couple years later, whatever, in the hood, he was doing his thing, whatever. Warming on the block, getting a little money, whatever. Then disappeared for a minute, let incident happen. Something happened with a female, he got shot. I see folks again in a wheelchair. Damn, what's going on, bro? He told me what happened. You know, all I can say is, I'm glad folks back, recovering, back in it. And we gonna do this year, we finna blow up. So I'm glad he getting back on this ground or whatever. We need him anyway. That's it.
Y'all talking about the music, right?
Yeah, I'm a rapper, by the way. Mm-hmm. FBG, that's the group, whatever. I'm being that black. You know, we do million views on YouTube. Y'all can check us out. Mm-hmm.
Let me get something off top of the dome, man.
Off top of the dome?
Off the dome.
I stay strapped, call a nigga Jabot. I empty the first six out, now it's time to reload. Leave a nigga thinner than paper, it's time to refold. We keep the Pelly and the Mac around, the time to get cold. Probably rip out his heart, try to reverse his soul, because he hot, a billion black cold. But if that don't work, I'm stalking his moms. Watch him run all the errands, and stake out a run. Come in the house strapped, book bag full of bombs. And we had the murder cut, cause we couldn't get our son. Getting bullets off, in the playground we having
Man, shit, FBG. We have 9 next. Gang.
Gang, man.
Dooski, my little cousin.
No, we just came to find out about a year or two ago. But how I met him, we was in the field together. You know, little problems here and there, you know. Called my little cousin Deuce putting shit up. Situation happened with him. They just walked me so I can go to see my probation. You know, I was on probation for it too. Law put on me, it wasn't mine. Still gonna say that to now. Seeing my probation officer, by the way, and get the phone call saying that dude got shot in his head, bad bitch, and she got away. I was so fucking heated that day that she got away. Not only that she shot him in his head, but she also got away out the house, past a couple people. I'm pissed off about it. So that happened. But the good thing that happened is that Doodoo, he's still here right next to me, you know, talking to me, laughing with me, joking. He's the funniest motherfucker on earth. He'll gun the shit out you, point blank period, any day. You could be flea, he's still gonna gun you.
I felt like God did this to him for a reason. It happened, and he put it on my shoulders for a reason. And what I take out of it, he pulled my family back even closer. Cause see, I had let that one little birdie out the nest. See, I got six in my nest. I let one birdie out the nest. It wasn't time for him to leave the nest. So God brought him back to the nest, you know? And Mama Bird gonna take care of baby bird. Always, always and forever. I wouldn't know what else to do, you know? If it happened to another one of my children, well, guess what? I'd do it all over again. I'm not gonna think twice about it, you know? To help people, I think God did this for a reason, you know? Stop being selfish. Help people. It's okay to help people. And it started with my son. And I helped him, and I'm continuing to help him. And if there's anybody else that I need to help, as a mother, as a friend, I'm gonna be there. You'll never have to wait. I'll never say no, because this is good, you know? You get a sense of, this is a blessing right here. You get another chance. You repair what was broken, you know? Family, that's what we're doing. We're repairing. We wasn't fully broken, but we got caught before it was. So now we're putting it back. We're putting it back. And I'm the queen. He's my king. He is my king. You know? And I wouldn't do it no other way. I wouldn't have it no other way. I have to be there, you know? And it just made me stronger. It made me love more, you know? It made me want to do more. It made me want to give more. And whoever I can give it to, I hope you take with you from this. Always be there for yours. When you think they don't want your guidance, they really do. When you think they don't need your guidance, they really do. Pay attention. Pay attention always, you know? Because tomorrow is not promised to nobody. And I thank God we got a second chance.
Okay, look over there.
And I don't want to take my hat off neither, because all dudes that got good hair got a big forehead. See that? You'll never find. Blah, 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 blah.
If there was something else you could change about that day, what would it be?
Answering the door. Man, that's crazy. Or even letting her in the house.
Or
just even arguing with her, period.
She was your ex?
No. No relationship whatsoever. I mean, we just was having sex. That was it. That was all. And it was good to her. It was okay to me, but it was good to her.
since she found out that you had a girlfriend?
She found out I had a girlfriend. I just remember sitting on the bed and pow, it was over. I actually thought I was sleeping until I woke up, seeing what I saw, and everything was just crazy. Like, man, my mama told me what happened. And
yeah, tell me more about what, at the hospital, how you felt at the hospital. Did you think you were gonna die? You felt like you were gonna die at any point in time?
No, because like after I knew that I had woke up from what had happened, like I just knew that everything was gonna be okay. Like I wasn't worried about nothing else. You know, my mama was by my side, you know. People was coming there now and then. Like most important part to me was that I had my mother. You know, she was there. That's all I needed. Period.
Did you ever lose hope any time during the recovery process, the rehab?
No, it's just once I found out the reason I couldn't walk was actually because I had the stroke on the right side of the right side of my brain. It affected the left side of my body. So I was paralyzed, fully paralyzed on the left side. I don't think fully, but like, you know, I had to do stuff to like get myself back together.
So what's the hardest thing for you to do right now?
Man, just like really like just coping with the whole situation at hand. Like I don't like it at all. I'm ready to just start walking and going about my business and getting in like how I used to. No dangerous stuff though, not at all.
So what's the type of stuff you can't do anymore?
I can't, like, when I first came home, I always, like, loved for somebody to, like, to turn out my light. And it was bothering me that I couldn't get up, you know, and maneuver around to get to the light switch. Because I had to lay in bed all day. And then, in the summertime, everybody came and went as they pleased and was outside, like, having water fights and stuff. Like, stuff I just could participate in. Like, that was just hard. Like, everybody going skating. Like, you know, I got to stay at home because I can't walk. But when I do walk, I look like Bambi or something, for real. I'm going to show y'all. Real name. Kevin Hart.
Yeah, real nigga, all day, on the block, by myself. You saw that before?
So you wanna go to this church, man? You wanna see what happened at church tonight? You excited about going to church?
No, I ain't excited. I just, like, hope it don't be boring, because I'll fall asleep. That's what happened, man. I've been doing that since a shawty. It was actually special guest. It was a lot of us. We were special guests at a church in Iowa, Decorah, Iowa, somewhere. And when they called our name, all of us was sitting in the front row. When they called our name, we was all up there. Everybody was sleeping when nobody woke. All of us. You know, because them Caucasian churches be so boring. They was singing.
Really amazing to me how excited Roderick was. I mean, he didn't show it, but I know he was. Because as soon as we got to the church, where the healing crusade was taking place, this man couldn't wait to show me that he knew how to walk by himself. I mean, it was his idea. This is before the church service even started, to actually get out of the chair. And he came up on that wheelchair ramp you see to the left of the screen. Well, when we got in there, he saw that stairwell and he's like, man, Myron, come on, let's go. Let me show you. I know how to go up there by myself. I can do it. I can get up there. He has so much will, so much determination, and so much faith that nothing can stop him. He's not gonna let anything stop him. And he proved that to me that day.
But I think all throughout this entire ordeal, he's been proving it to himself. He wanted to climb these stairs. I guess in a way, he was kind of saying that I'm gonna climb this mountain that's in front of me. I'm not about to let this slow me down.
You see the other room?
Is the rail too low?
Why you hold it like that, best friend? Cause
it's too
low. Low right there. So he just got to come down again. Just take that one more step.
Let's just jump all the way to the
No.
Jumping. Oh my gosh. There we go. Just take your time.
Take
you got
your
time,
it. Use your strong leg to come down, Dudu. My comedy dooski is on camera. I ain't gonna do no dooski, y'all not doodle. You got it, little cuz. Take your time. That rail ain't gonna fall, doodle. Don't worry about that.
Hey,
hey,
you got
that
rail?
Yeah, I got that rail.
You got that rail?
When you get down again.
Almost up, then work.
Right. When you get down again, grab the bigger pole. Use the right leg through the, and then your left leg. Don't get scared. He got you, you ain't gonna fall.
You let go now.
Nah, I ain't gonna let go.
These last couple steps, let me do the last couple.
No, just come on, Dudu.
Put your arm right here first.
It's good that you're trying to push yourself.
You spread your face up, then you're going to be looking all crazy.
I already look good.
You okay? You look good, baby. You still a boss. I see you, you fresh. You got your trues on, fresh ones on.
You know, turn around. Catch my jeans.
That's what I'm talking about. Catch my jeans. Where's your chair? Wait.
Feel the same.
You did good. You did good, hey. You think you're independent, you can't just do it by yourself. I just let you go.
I mean, I bet you if I had to, I'd walk down the stairs on my own, I bet you I could.
Now we ain't gonna let you fall. Come on, bro. Come on, bro.
I can't let it go.
I didn't want you to let it go. I see.
Do something else amazing.
We're gonna be out here with us next time, boy. Turn up. I already know.
It only takes one drop of water
begin to flood. One day can change an entire life. Or, in Roderick's case, an entire family forever. In a moment, 1 second in time, one bullet. But when the rain starts in our lives, we have a decision to make. We can either stare at the windowsills of our lives, come, panic, and be in despair and depression and give up. Or we can take the Noah's Ark and something that floats on the water. As long as we have our umbrellas, we'll be okay. As long as we have our hope, as long as we have our peace, as long as we have our dignity, as long as we have our faith, we'll be fine. Roderick never lost hope, and for that reason, he's a testimony to us all. Flood, one bad situation that's to slow you down in life. I think that's the biggest thing that Roderick taught me. You don't let situations control you. You sure didn't. At any given cost, have to control the situation. Because that's how God made us. We're made in his image. We're made to dominate. We're made to rule, not to be rude. And Roderick made that decision that he wasn't going to be ruled by this. Thank you.